Call to order the Finance Committee meeting for March 7th, 2017. Our first item will be a presentation by our mayor at this time.
If we could join down in the front, we've got an employee of the month to recognize.
It's an honor to have an employee of the month to be recognized again, and we so much appreciate the 450-some employees of the city of Muskogee. This month, March 2017, Tim Dorner. Tim Dorner has been working with the city since November 2011. Tim started working with the Parks Department on a mowing crew and quickly moved to the Forestry Division. He is now the Forestry Maintenance Leader 1. Tim likes to be outside and is lucky to have a position that places me outdoors every day. Some months that'd be good and some would be pretty chilly, wouldn't it? Tim likes planting trees, which provides more clean air, shade, and beauty in our city. In his spare time, Tim likes to run, bike, and be outdoors whenever he can. He prefers to be outdoor by the lake, in the river, where he can breathe easy and enjoy the beauty of nature. Tim enjoys working with the forestry crew as they have seemed to have fun but still get the job completed as required. Tim was nominated because he is dedicated to promoting tree care and is diligent to the process of caring for the city's trees. In addition to the time spent with the forestry crew, Tim is also involved in helping set up the light display at Honor Heights Park and dedicates much of his time in the winter months to brightening up the park and the city. And Tim, we just want to say thank you. And I've got a certificate for you, but we're going to let you go around and shake everybody's hand, and then we will hand you the certificate and let you say something if you want to say a word or two to us. Would you like to make a comment as well?
Not really. Just thank you, and I appreciate the honor and enjoy working here.
All right. Thank you, sir. We appreciate it, and congratulations. Appreciate it.
Agenda item number one, please.
Consider approval of Finance Committee minutes of February 21st, 2017.
Reviewing the minutes, are there any corrections?
Move for approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second to approve the minutes. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Cale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item number one passed. Item number two, please.
Consider approval of claims for all city departments February 16, 2017 through February 28, 2017.
Do we have a report from the purchasing committee?
Yes, sir. The purchasing committee met earlier today and went over the department of claims, and I move for approval.
Have a motion. We have a second.
Second.
Have a motion and a second to approve the claims. Any discussion? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Cale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item number two passed. Item number three, please.
Consider approval of a contract with Safety National Casualty Company for excess workers' compensation insurance in the amount of $92,791 or take other necessary action.
Mr. Tucker?
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, it's time for our annual renewal of our excess carry insurance for workers' compensation. Fortunately, when we went out for quotes, our existing carrier was very reasonable. Their increase was only 3% in the premium, so that was very positive. So that amount is $92,791. For renewal with the same carrier with the same limits as we had last year. We did obtain quotes from Midwest employers as well on different options. For them, 500 limit, 550,000 limit, and a $600,000 limit. And for all of the limits, they were more expensive than our current carrier. So as a result, I do recommend approval of renewing with Safety National with the premium in the amount of $92,791. Happy to answer any questions.
I've got a question. Excess workers' compensation.
We're self-insured for our workers' compensation injuries up to a certain level.
Oh, so this is above and beyond.
Correct.
Thank you.
Move the approval.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Any other questions or discussion?
Mr. Tucker, how often do the rates go up on average?
Every year.
Every year?
12 months.
Because I'm wondering if we're able to keep up with that as we go on with municipalities across the state having flat budgets. At some point, do we assess how we do it to be certain that we can keep up?
I'm not sure I understand.
In other words, from a budget perspective, if it goes up 2 or 3% every year, that's going to have to come from someplace else. So do we project out in a way that we can plan for that?
The typical increase depends a lot on what's going on with the state legislature.
Mm-hmm.
For example, in 2013, when we had the workers' compensation reform that came through, their premium did dip ever so slightly. However, as those provisions, those protections that were incorporated are becoming less and less based on what litigation has held, you're looking at a rate increase all around. Now, can I predict that in the next couple of years it'll still be around 2 or 3%? No,
all right.
I can't. A lot of it has to do with our claims and what their experience is with us, and that is something that we are trying diligently to improve, and that was done through an action with you all creating our safety department. And so that has now been moved under my purview, and so we will continue to monitor and ensure additional safe practices, because the fewer claims that we have, the better our premiums are going to be. And so in that regard, we do have some level of control.
Mm-hmm.
However, it's, of course, as you can imagine, not an immediate fix. It's something that we have to work forward and change our culture to be that of a safe working environment.
Thank you.
but other than that, there really are no assurances as to what we can expect our premium increases to be. We just have to watch it very carefully and hope that our those who we solicit quotes from are competitive. And if not, we keep looking.
Okay.
Any other questions? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item number 3 pass. Item number 4, please.
Consider approval to purchase the best bid for one used Class 8 day cab, Kenworth T800 haul truck, in the amount of $78,500 from Bruckner's, or take other necessary action.
Mrs. Whipton.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. We are working to improve the fleet through the Public Works Department. A few weeks back, if you recall, we brought forth to you a hydraulic sliding axle trailer, which you all approved purchase for. This truck will be used in conjunction with that to pull this trailer around. This truck will be equipped with what is called a wet kit, which is a hydraulic system to operate that hydraulic sliding axle. That will also be able to be used on what is called an in-dump trailer, which is basically an oversized dump truck type trailer. You've seen them hauling asphalt and stuff on job sites, I'm sure. But so it gives us a lot of flexibility with this particular type truck that we're seeking to purchase. We went out for bids for this. We received 4 bids back. The bid that we're recommending is the best bid from Bruckner's Truck, and it is due to the mileage, and it also meets our specifications better than some of the others. The mileage on this truck, as you can see listed there, is only 89,000 miles, which is extremely low for a vehicle of this nature. The other ones are up over 400,000 on some of them. The truck that just stands out, and I'll just address that, is the truck from Premier, which is quite a bit cheaper. It's a little over 2 feet, nearly 3 feet shorter than what we need for our needs. We looked at it closely and decided that it just would not meet our specifications, would not meet our needs. So unfortunately, that truck is pretty much out. When they did bid that, it did fall in the exempt category of that, but that's the only truck that they had used that they had to bid, so that's why they included that in the bid. The truck was located in Oklahoma City. We sent our street superintendent, David Garner, and one of our mechanics there to Oklahoma City. They spent the better part of a day looking it over, driving it. It is everything that it's supposed to be. We were very, very pleased with the truck, and it will be funded out of the Public Works capital outlay. There was some discussion on warranty, so I want to clarify that. So I did get some additional information about it. I got secondhand information on what the warranty was going to be. The people that went and looked at it, Mr. Garner and Mr. Graber, the mechanic, they were told it had about a year left on a partial factory warranty. The other trucks had no warranty. They were sold as is, where is. So whatever the warranty is will beat nothing, which the other bids were. There's a picture of the truck, just so you have an idea of what a day cab is. It's basically a semi without a sleeper on it. Behind the cab is a aluminum headache rack that will hold all the chains and boomers, and then there'll be a hydraulic tank mounted right behind that, and that's partial need for the extended length, is to be able to have room to accommodate that hydraulic tank. Once again, this we felt was the best truck with the extremely low miles. So we are recommending purchase of this truck from Bruckner's in the amount of $78,500. Be happy to answer any additional questions. Mr. Garner couldn't be here today, but Mr. Stewart, I believe, is prepared to answer any specific questions related to Public Works and the operation of it within his department.
Has this truck ever been wrecked or anything, or is it?
No.
Because the reason why I'm asking that is because the other three bids were like 270, 358, 400,000 miles. This one has 89,000 miles on it, and they're offering it at a reasonable price of what some of the other ones are. I was just kind of like, why? How is that possible?
It is slightly higher in price due to the low miles, and the 400,000 miles is not uncommon for a truck of this nature. So the other ones fell in what would be considered a normal mileage. This one's just abnormal, and the ad for that is just not quite as great as you may think.
Well, it's a pretty truck.
It's a very, very good truck, solid truck.
To follow up on Dan's question, so the 400,000-mile truck and the 87,000-mile truck are identical trucks?
No, they were two different trucks. One was a Kenworth. The other one, I believe, was a Volvo, which is kind of unusual, the 408,000-mile truck. Volvo, while it may be a good truck, it is out of what is standard for our fleet, so we would be less familiar with all the maintenance and operation, and the parts would not be as interchangeable as they might be with some of the other, which we do have a Kenworth in our fleet that we recently purchased as our last sanitation truck, so some of the things would be more interchangeable there. When you start getting out into the Mercedes, Volvo type market, you start getting into specifics that are more specific for that manufacturer, more specific engines and stuff, and the software to be able to maintain those is a little harder to obtain, just like if you had a Mercedes car.
Well, you answered my question, because Mr. Hall's train of thought, I think, and mine was 87,000 miles, 400,000 miles, and it's only another $20,000. Wow, what a bargain. But it's a different truck.
Exactly.
Okay.
Move the approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any other questions? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Scully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Item number four passed. Item number five, please.
Consider approval of receiving donated funds for the month of January 2017 in the amount of $195 for the city's animal shelter sponsorship program as per the attached list, or take other necessary action.
Chief.
Mr. Chairman, as you know, we receive donations on a monthly basis for our sponsorship program at the animal shelter. And for the month of January of 2017, we received $195, and I would request that we receive these monies.
Move for approval.
Second.
Have a motion and a second. Any questions? Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
All right. Item number five passed, and that was the final item on the Finance Committee.
We'll now call to order the Public Works Committee meeting. Item number one.
Consider approval of Public Works Committee minutes of February 21st, 2017.
Any additions or changes?
Move for approval.
Second.
A motion and a second. Any discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
Motion carries. Item number two.
Hold a public hearing and take action on the approval of an ordinance rezoning the property located at 4301 West Muskogee Avenue, more particularly described in the ordinance, from C1 Local Commercial District to R4 Multifamily Residential District, and if approved, authorize staff to revise the official zoning map of the city to reflect said change or take other necessary action.
We're now in the public hearing. Mr. Garvin.
Mr. Chairman, members of the committee, the applicants are requesting approval to rezone property from the C1 Local Commercial District to the R4 Multifamily Residential District. The property is located at 4301 West Muskogee Avenue. It's on the south side of Muskogee, just east of 44th Street. The reason for the rezoning, the owner of the apartment complex is refinancing the property, and the lender is requesting that the property rezone to its current use, which is an apartment complex. Looking at the existing zoning land use, the site is currently zoned C1 local commercial, and there's an existing apartment complex. To the north is zoned local commercial. There's a fairly new apartment complex, and across Muskogee Street is a couple medical facilities. To the south, which is across Columbus Avenue, is zoned R1 single family and A agricultural, and it's undeveloped property and a single family dwelling. And to the east is zoned C3 regional commercial, and there is some light industrial also, and it's Dollar General store. To the west, which is across 44th Street, is a housing authority residential development, West Side Terrace. Again, the reason for the rezoning is they're in the process of financing the existing apartments. The lender is requesting that it be rezoned to the multifamily use, which is the appropriate use for the apartments, to comply with any lender and insurance requirements. Currently, this property is classified as a non-conforming use. It became a non-conforming use in 2014. That's when we updated our zoning regulations. If you'll remember back previously, our zoning regulations build up on one another. In other words, if the property was zoned commercial, it would allow any type of residential within a commercial zone. If it was zoned industrial, it would allow any type of commercial. When we revised our regulations, we changed over to a standalone zoning, which means it has to be zoned for that use. That's why this property became a non-conforming use in 2014. This item was recommended for approval by both staff and Planning Commission. Be glad to answer any questions.
We had no one sign up to speak to this item, so we're going to close the public hearing. Any questions, discussion?
Move for approval.
Move for approval.
Got a motion and a second?
Second.
Second, thank you. Motion and a second. Any other discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
And the motion carries. Item number three.
Hold a public hearing and take action on the approval of an ordinance rezoning the property located at 300 North 33rd Street, more particularly described in the ordinance, from R1 Single Family Residential District to C1 Local Commercial District, and if approved, authorize staff to revise the official zoning map of the city to reflect said change or take other necessary action.
We have one person to speak to this item, and after Mr. Garvin gives his presentation, I'm going to allow him to speak at that point in time. We are now in a public hearing. Mr. Garvin.
Mr. Chair and members of the committee, the applicant is requesting approval to rezone the property from the R1 single-family residential district to the C1 local commercial district. This property is located at 300 North 33rd Street. It's on the northeast corner of 33rd and Court Street. The reason for the rezoning is the existing commercial business, Landmark Cancer Center, is proposing to expand their parking area. Looking at the existing zoning land use, starting with the site is zoned R1, and there is a single-family dwelling currently on the property. To the north is zoned R1, and there is a single-family dwelling. To the south is zoned R1, single-family dwelling. To the east is zoned C1 local commercial, and it's Landmark Cancer Center. This is an old aerial, so what you're seeing is actually the old Brahms. I've got another one here I'll show you in a minute that shows the new development, but you can see in the picture the Landmark Cancer Center. And back west, which is across 33rd Street, is zoned R1 and a single-family dwelling. Now, at the Planning Commission, there were several questions, comments, concerns about this rezoning. And the items that was brought up was, for example, on the parking lot, could we restrict it to only parking use, no other type of commercial use? There was questions about the landscaping, green area, access, or where the approaches were going to be, maintenance of the parking lot, site-proof fencing, utilities and easements, for if the property was in foreclosure, and a certificate of need. So I'm briefly going to try to go through and explain each one of those questions and what the answers to those questions are.
Were these staff questions or citizen questions?
Citizens questions, okay. And staff. Some of those were actually staff or, well, committee member questions. Here's an aerial showing the Landmark Cancer Center, and they are proposing to extend the parking lot, build the parking lot over where the existing single-family dwelling is now, which will be 28 spaces. As far as can we limit it to parking lot use only? And stated that the answer to that was no. Once it is rezoned C1, any use allowed within the C1 would be allowed on the property. Now, C1 is the most restrictive commercial zoning that we have. The reason why it's the most restrictive is typically it's adjacent to residential areas. And the use is tried to be limited so it will not have a major impact to the adjoining residential areas. Next question was landscaping. They are required to provide landscaping. What I've highlighted in green is the grass area. Along Court Street and 33rd Street is basically the grass right-of-way area. The green area you see between the parking lot, which will be north of the parking lot and the single-family dwelling, is a buffer area that the regulations requires. They require a 6-foot buffer area between a parking lot and a budding residential used or occupied property. So they would have to have a 6-foot green space at that location. The landscaping ordinance also requires 4 trees. Due to the size of the property, it's based on the size. This would require 4 trees to be installed. The trees cannot be installed in the right-of-way. They have to be installed on private property. Typically, they're installed in the buffer area separating the two. Even though it's not required, the applicant has stated that they would also provide some shrubs or bushes along 33rd Street, just some more landscaping on that side just to kind of camouflage or hide the parking lot. Next question was access or approaches. Where were they going to be located? What I've highlighted is the two existing approaches, the one off of 32nd Street and one off of Court. There will be no additional approaches installed. They will use those existing approaches to get to the parking. Next question was maintenance. There were some questions on who was going to maintain the parking lot. Well, the parking lot would be owned by Landmark Cancer Center, and they would be responsible for maintaining it, just like they're responsible for maintaining the existing building and existing parking lot. Another question was site-proof fence. The zoning regulations does require site-proof fence between commercial and residential uses. So the area next to the parking lot would be required to have a site-proof or a solid screen fence, as the ordinance refers to, between the parking lot and the residential area. The other red line showing a site-proof fence is behind the existing Landmark Cancer Center. There were some questions that all of that there was not a site-proof fence the full length, which does not impact this zoning request. But they are required to install a site-proof fence whether the zoning is improved or not, and they have already been preliminarily notified that that would be a requirement. So they will have to install that fence one way or the other. Next issue was utilities and easements. There were some questions on where the utilities are and if there's any easements across this property. The water line runs down 33rd and Court Street. The sewer main runs down the alley between the lots. If for some reason the city has to get in and make repairs to that sewer main, they'll cut up the parking lot, make the repairs, and it'll be up to the property owner to pour new concrete back on the parking lot. You can build a parking lot on an easement. You just cannot put any structures on an easement. Next question, there were some questions about the property being in foreclosure. I don't know anything about that. Drew Wilcoxon, who represents the applicant, could probably answer that question for you. There were some questions about a certificate of need. If you remember, anytime a medical facility goes in, we need to look at if certificate of need is required if it's competing with the hospital. They did make a request or submit an application. We reviewed it along with the attorney's office at that time and determined it did not meet the definition of a hospital or emergency room facility. Therefore, it was not required. In closing, I'd probably also add, if you look at the comprehensive plan, the comprehensive plan states that the area along 32nd Street and the area along Muskogee is not only identified as retail use, it also encourages medical facilities. They are considering the hospital as the anchor for that area, and it encourages any type of medical or professional services for that hospital. It also furthermore states that, It also states that the city should not only strengthen but expand the existing medical offices, and it states along 32nd Street in particular. So this does comply with recommendations from the comprehensive plan. The only other thing I would add before I close is if you look at 32nd Street, and if you go a block south or a block north of this site, the existing commercial already extends between 32nd and 33rd or beyond 33rd. If you go across 32nd Street to the east, all of that commercial extends from 32nd down to 31st Street. So there's really only about a block and three-fourths that does not currently extend to 33rd Street or beyond along North 32nd Street. This item has been recommended for approval by staff and Planning Commission. And again, Drew is here representing the applicant if you have any questions of him.
Thank you, Mr. Garvin. Alex Wilson, coming up to the microphone, and we need your name and your address, please, sir.
My name is Alex Wilson. Is a P.O. Box okay?
Pam, P.O. Box works for you?
P.O. Box what?
P.O. Box 1067 in Muskogee, 74402. Okay. I'm with a law firm, Brennan Smith & Trevini, and I'm here to represent Jim Endicott.
Okay.
And Mr. Endicott actually lives in the property just to the north of where you see that proposed zoning change there. And he came to me with quite a few concerns that we brought up yesterday. I'm going to start by pointing out just the primary thing that I want everybody to remember, if they will, while we go over this. You mentioned how the zoning regulations and ordinances were changed in standalone. And I look at the single family R1, which currently is what that property is. And it says that these areas are intended to be defined and protected from the encroachment of uses not performing a function necessary to the residential environment, internal stability, attractiveness, order, and efficiency. And I look at that, and it talks about a proper functional relationship of each element. And I had the opportunity to go out to Mr. Endicott's property yesterday and get an idea better of what this fence would do. I didn't make 12 copies for you all, but if you can kind of see, I'm sure many of you are familiar, when you walk out your door, you get to see something like this. There's going to be a 6-foot fence, wooden fence going across here. That's all we know. We don't know what kind of wood, if it's going to be painted, if it's going to be weather sealed, but that view is going to be gone if this change is approved. And so our primary concerns are not only how it affects property values, how it affects, and also I want to mention as well, B, who lives across the street from Mr. Endicott, is also present today. She didn't get here in time to sign up and get 5 minutes, but I want you to know that Mr. Endicott is not the only one that has an issue and has concerns about how this will affect the value of their property and affect them moving forward. So you know those purposes there. A C1 purpose is to minimize disruption and undesirable impact, which I think property values impact on that is a great concern for everybody that is currently living on that street. The fact that they were required to have that fence behind the building, which isn't part of this, but he mentioned the red line going up, that fence, actually, there was one when Brahms was there, that fence was taken out and then never replaced. Mr. Endicott's property has a chain link fence behind it, and he just looks at the back of that building right now. Apparently, they have said that they will take care of that along with this fence that we've been told will be put here later on as well. That's one of our big concerns about the maintenance of this. And he discussed the foreclosure, and Mr. Wilcoxon may be able to address that. Just looking into it very superficially at first, I saw that there was a lien from Lock Supply, there was a lien from Brooks Electric, and the reason I looked at this, I had somebody that came into my office that did flooring work on it. He was too late to file a lien, but he was not paid for the services he performed in the construction of that building, so he had to seek other recourse. But so there were those two liens, and then there was also an existing lien for about $20,000 from a concrete company, which I assume did the rest of that parking lot. So these three liens are outstanding as far as I know, and there was also a lawsuit filed by Brett Smith, another attorney here, that represented Brooks Electric to foreclose on that lien. And I looked at it and I shared that yesterday. That lawsuit is still pending. And my concern is if you change this zoning requirement on here, today or next week at the city council meeting, and you allow this to go forward and they get trucks out there and they hire workers to come and start doing work, well, what if they get foreclosed on? Those trucks pull out and we have half a parking lot with no fence for these neighbors to look at and be concerned about. I don't think anybody would want to walk out their door and see that just sitting there, eyesore, sitting right next to them, not taken care of, maybe not even able to sell it because it is constructed to be a medical facility and that's a very specific use. Another huge concern on that, and until those liens, until that lawsuit are all taken care of, I don't think there should be anything allowed as far as them trying to put this parking lot in. If they can't pay the concrete person from the last time, I doubt they'll pay it this time. And those are huge concerns for the neighbors that are sitting around this property. If they walk out their door in the morning, they don't want to see a fence, first of all, but they don't want to see half of a parking lot, or they don't want to see a demolished house that's just flat and laying there in pieces with nobody with enough money to come and clean it up. If they weren't going to take care of the requirements when they were supposed to put in that fence, we have concerns about them taking care of requirements going forward. And that's why we would ask more detail needs to be provided before any of this should be allowed to move forward. The effect that it will have, the blatant violation it has of that goal for the R1 residential property, talking about harmony, talking about stability and adequate air, light, open space, you saw that view that Mr. Endicott has now with that house, which will be covered by 6 feet of wood. And that's the only specification we have. We don't know what kind of fence. These are concerns. I think more particulars are required moving forward before you allow this encroachment into a residential area all along the back there. And they haven't explored other options, which that's something they should be required to do first as well. And thank you all.
Thank you, Mr. Wilson. Do we have any questions for Mr. Wilson? We've got 5 minutes to...
I've got a question. Did you make it known the other day that your client had started negotiations or had intentions of negotiations with this medical facility to sell his property to him?
Yesterday, there was no negotiation. He has hired a realtor that was contacted by, and this is double hearsay, I'm sorry, but his realtor, Gary Dunlap, was contacted by Landmark and given an offer on the house that was a fraction of what he believes the value is and what he believes it will sell for in the future. And so he outright turned it down. I don't think there's been any other communication between him and Landmark other than through Mr. Dunlap.
Okay. Thank you.
Any other questions for Mr. Wilson? Seeing no one else has signed up to speak to this issue, we're going to close the public hearing. Mr. Garvin, we had any questions for Mr. Garvin?
I'd like to answer one concern that was made about the site-proof fence. The site-proof fence would have to be installed in accordance with our regulations. And our regulation says for the front yard setback, the 25 feet, So that'd be from the property line back 25 feet, not from the curb, but from the property line. A fence cannot be any higher than 4 feet before it goes up to 6. So, and the reason for that is so people in their front yard, it's not blocking the view. So the fence would have to be installed in accordance to the regulations. The regulation just says a solid screen fence. It lists, it could be a wood fence, it could be concrete, it can be brick, as long as it is a solid screen style fence.
So Gary, who maintains these? Because I see
it'd be up to the commercial construction or the commercial property to maintain the fence.
And is there any enforcement codes? Because I see several businesses throughout town, the privacy fence is there, and then they're deteriorating.
Typically, which we don't go out looking for them, so to speak, but when we get a complaint, we do go out and address it. And to my knowledge, no one's ever called us about any issues on this fence.
Okay.
They might have contacted the property owner, but they have not contacted our department.
Okay.
I'd like to address the issue.
Drew is the applicant.
Okay. Please, Drew.
There's only been one lawsuit filed, and there's been no action on it since 2015. My client got crosswise with a gravel provider. It's been settled. The lawyers just, you know how lawyers are, they just put stuff off. They don't get stuff filed on time. There are no liens against this property that we're aware of. I mean, we didn't spend over $1 million to build this cancer treatment center and offer Ms. Breedlove, my client, thousands of dollars to buy her house to have this go into foreclosure over the parking lot property, okay? It's going to be a nice parking lot. We're going to landscape it. We're not open nights. We're not open weekends. We don't create any noise. We don't create any problems. We're not going to let you park that truck that you just bought on it. I think it's going to be an improvement, and I think it should pass. Any questions?
I have one for Gary, but it may lead into Drew. One, Gary, I appreciate, the work of your staff and all the time. You know, visual really does help answer a lot of the questions that came from everybody. But with a parking lot like that, sometimes there will be the need for lighting that will be on a parking lot. Even though it's not after hours, sometimes you will need lighting. How does the code address that you won't have lighting going over to residential where it's impacting residential neighborhoods? Because, you know, that can be a big impact, that you'll have lighting noise that will impact.
The lighting is supposed to be set up and designed so it does not intrude on the adjacent property, which means it would have to be facing the parking lot and not shining over on the abutting property. Now, if I'm not mistaken, it was stated in the meeting that since they do not work nights or weekends, that I don't even think they're planning on installing lighting on the parking lot itself.
But just thinking about the use as it might develop in the future with the parking lot, hours might be extended.
Adjacent
property. I'm just trying to make sure we would still have provisions in our ordinances that would make sure that lighting noise would not affect the neighborhood.
Yes, they are in effect in the ordinance.
Okay. And that's addressed by foot candles or?
The way it's addressed, it just says it shall not intrude or encroach onto adjacent property, which means it's supposed to be completely on the property, which is very difficult to do. But basically, it says it has to be on the property and not any on the adjacent property.
But it's clearly addressed in our
clearly
current.
Clearly addressed and very pretty strict.
Okay. I appreciate you addressing every one of them, but I just noticed that the lighting wasn't addressed there, so I wanted to make sure.
I think a statement was made that because they're not open after dark, after hours, that the light, so I didn't even think about putting the light on.
I was just wanting to think of, hey, if this did change hands, and maybe the next user was going to say, hey, we're going to use it for something different than that, and that parking is going to be open till 7 o'clock at night, then you would have to have lighting in it.
Correct.
So
correct.
We want to make sure and protect our residents where they don't have that lighting noise. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Mr. Tucker, could I make a suggestion, and you can tell me if I can make this? Can we move this with no action necessary? Because I would like to verify that the lawsuits have been settled. But I didn't know if we could do that or if we need to bring this up to a vote now or whatever this committee wants to do. But I'd like to put that as a thought to take no action on this until Monday night.
You can take no action. You can forward it. I think Gary would prefer without recommendation due to his publications.
Yes.
Because this will, I mean, the public hearing that is required by the charter and state law is the official public hearing of the city council. We always do two public hearings so that the committee can also have one.
Mm-hmm.
So it is appropriate, Mr. Deputy Mayor, if you would like to request that this be forwarded without recommendation to city council.
Do we have a way to verify whether there's any liens left on this property?
Should be record.
Should be.
Oh, well, there was a lawsuit. I think you mentioned that there was a lawsuit, and you say it's settled. You know, I just want to make sure we do it the right way. I want to make sure.
I've got a question.
And I can certainly reach out to, you said Brett Smith was representing one of the parties.
He represented the plaintiff. In the old age, you'd call a lawyer, they would call you back. But in the new age,
Well, I talked to him today, so I know he's around.
I know he's around.
I could support your train of thought. I'm a little concerned that we use speculation or conjecture on something that doesn't necessarily apply to what's at hand.
Okay.
And delving into speculation or conjecture of things that aren't pertinent to what's being asked for, is it something that we need to be involved in or not? Maybe it is, but I that's just a concern of mine. I could be supportive to your train of thought with just that.
I just wanted to
caution.
Put it out there.
It doesn't slow anything down if we move it forward without recommendation, because it could still be heard on Monday night. So thought, but that certainly would give us from now until then to clear up some of those concerns.
I can support that.
And it doesn't count till Monday night anyway.
Right.
And that's why I just want to put that was just food for thought. And if anybody, this committee wants to move forward, I'm fine with that also. Yes, sir. It is for me. I think that's a valid point for them. Okay. I really do. Because I would hate for it to get a project get started and not be completed. That's just my personal opinion. I'm not speaking for this committee.
And I agree along the same lines with the chairman, only because, not just because of the lawsuit, but I think when we have these type of residential concerns, it's almost impossible for council to settle this as a committee in 45 minutes or an hour. So I'm comfortable as well moving it without action until we get our due diligence to be certain we can make a good decision on Monday night.
So consensus to move forward with no recommendation?
Is for me.
Very good. Thank you. Let's see. Item number 4.
Consider approval of an ordinance of the city of
water first,
I think I might.
Okay.
Consider
this on purpose.
Thanks. Consider approval of an ordinance of the city of Muskogee, Oklahoma, repealing Division 1 generally, including Section 2-99 through 2-111, and Division 2 administrative reorganization, including Sections 2-112 through 2-120, all within Chapter 2 administration, Article 4, administrative departments and offices, all for the purpose of replacing the repeal provisions with a new division and section pursuant hereto in this 2017 citywide reorganization and modernization ordinance, creating Division 1, administration reorganization, creating Section 2-99, citation of division, creating 2-100, office of the city manager, establishing office of and duties, creating Section 2-101, administrative departments and divisions, establishing authority to create and maintain organizational structure, creating Section 2-102, office of the city attorney, establishing office and duties, creating Section 2-103, office of the city clerk, establishing office and duties and divisions, creating Section 2-104, Department of the Public Works, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-105, Department of Planning and Economic Economic Development, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-106, Department of Parks and Recreation, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-107, Department of Human Resources, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-108, Department of Information Technology, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-109, Department of Finance, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-110, Department of Fleet Management, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-111, Department of Purchasing, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-112, Department of Emergency Management, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-113, Police Department, establishing duties and department and duties, creating Section 2-114, Fire Department, establishing department and duties, creating Section 2-123, other divisions, establishing administrative divisions, reserving Section 2-115 through 2-122 for future uses, all within Chapter 2, Administration, Article 4, Administrative Departments and Offices, Division 1, Administrative Reorganization, providing for repealer, severability, codification, and setting an effective date.
And you did that with one breath.
Thank you.
Clearly outstanding.
I'm going to inform this committee. I'm going to vote no just so I get to hear this Monday night.
You're not funny.
Mr. Tucker.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the committee. You all may remember this discussion back from June of 2016 when we talked about doing a rewrite of our administrative of the code relating to our administrative departments within the city. That decision was after the 2014 Administrative Reorganization and Modernization Ordinance, which did not work as well as intended. There were some additional departments that were created, and what this ordinance will do is essentially revoke many of the provisions of the 2014 code to bring it back to how the original ordinance establishing the department was, with some changes that I want to go over. This, as Pam read, this ordinance will create every department within the city. It will also create divisions. The divisions under the charter are required to be created by the council. Those have historically been operating, but they've never been in an ordinance form. And so what we're doing essentially is articulating those within our ordinance to put into paper what has been our practice for decades, if not a century or more. And so that's why we've labeled this as the modernization ordinance, to essentially do some housekeeping measures as well. One of the larger changes within the ordinance will be to grant the city manager the authority to deal with the reporting structure. He can move, reassign any reporting structure of any department or any divisions. If you look at the ordinance, divisions are created within the very last section. And so what we've done is any division that exists within the city now, we've created within that section. Excluded from that are what we've deemed as operational units or divisions which are created by contract. In the IFF contract, the collective bargaining agreement, there are a couple of divisions that are created, and those are created by contract, which is of course approved by the council. So those were not readdressed within the ordinance, because if for some reason we negotiate a different CBA, there was no need to revise the ordinance. What our attempt was to do was to make this as working friendly as possible, so that the manager would have the authority to reorganize the department's supervision if he deemed it necessary. And so how the question then becomes is, how is the council notified of who reports to who and when? We have included a safeguard within the ordinance that will require that the manager provide an organizational chart to the council in accordance with the budget. And that chart will be attached to the budget when it's adopted each year. And so any changes made by the manager, for example, to move the safety department under the city manager, to move the airport under Public Works, things like that, those will be articulated within that organizational chart that is presented to the council in accordance with the budget. The other thing that was included here was something that was discussed with you all between you all and me relating to the authority to hire and fire my own assistants. As you know, back in, I believe, 2007, and Councilor Boydston, you may remember this, the city attorney and the assistant city attorney at the time were both council appointees. Sometime in 2007, which was before I arrived, there was a change to make the assistant city attorney, he was supervised by the city attorney, but he was under the purview of the city manager. So you had the potential, and it worked great for a few years while I was in that role. But when you look at what the potential could be, you have the city attorney who is appointed by the council to represent all city departments, the council, and the city manager. So what you have is if you have an assistant city attorney who is supervised, or the authority to hire and fire is with the manager, then you have a potential conflict there. If the manager doesn't like the advice that the city attorney gives, he has more control over the assistant city manager. And that was discussed with you all during the contract negotiations with me. And one of the things we talked about doing was correcting that via ordinance. And that way, I would have the authority to hire and fire any assistants. Now, this does not have anything to do with the administrative staff. Those are all, of course, employees of the city manager and would, of course, be merit protected. With that, those are the major changes. I think Mr. Miller has a few words that he would like to add to that. But before I turn that over, may I answer any questions for you?
So, yes, my brain was already kicking into high gear. So by this ordinance, he could actually go in and redesign the whole police department and say, we got one chief, one deputy chief, and everybody else falls underneath, and that's how it's going to be?
Well, he has the authority to do that now. So, yes. But that recommendation would come from the chief. I mean, he wouldn't be able to – well, I guess technically everyone works for the manager under the charter, so technically he would be able to do that. But practically speaking, it would come through the chief. Unless there was something conflicting that was articulated in the collective bargaining agreement, because this would not usurp anything within the collective bargaining agreement.
Okay.
And could it only be done once a year when he submits the budget?
No, he could do it. Presumably, it would be not efficient to do it multiple times in a year. But there's only one requirement that the council be notified within that time. Now, that doesn't mean that if it happens at mid-year that the manager couldn't still notify you all of that modification or change, but that there would only be one required. I understand. But that's to ensure that something doesn't happen and no one's ever aware of it, that, you know, maybe airport now reports to Gary Garvin in the planning department, things like that. Well,
I thought you had to do it right when the budget was submitted.
No, that's just the time that the council is notified.
So this is more like modernization and reorganization light more than repeal and replace.
Well, we are repealing and replacing the 2014 ordinance, as well as some language in the prior ordinance that had existed pre-1993. For example, the Department of HR was called the Department of Personnel. The Department of IT was called the Department of Data Processing. So those are some modernizing changes that were made. But this is not sweeping changes, I think, is what your question relates to. No, this is essentially how it is done now, but we have articulated that way in 10 years from now, someone can say, why were these departments created? How was the structure decided, rather than having to say, well, we've always done it that way.
And circumstances do change from time to time.
Yes.
And it might.
But the change was really, the real change would be that before council had to approve structural changes, where now
that was never clear, really.
It was never clear. Mm-hmm. Right. And now it gives the authority of the city manager that he can do that.
It is clear now.
Now it makes it clear.
Yes.
Now it makes it clear at his discretion. And the city council sets that structure.
Yes.
So Mr.
And
Touch
the city
is what
manager
our
can manage.
Was.
The city manager can manage.
Yes.
Deputy
so
Mayor.
Don't I you might have to refresh my memory, Office of the City Clerk. So the City Clerk is now going to hire the Revenue Division or the Revenue Manager and the Court Clerk Manager?
That is in a pre-existing ordinance.
Okay, that so was that was not ordinary. Changed.
Yeah, that was in a different section within the code that I've just incorporated within the administrative code. Because the most difficult thing you can do as a staffer is try to figure out what authority you have and have to look in multiple places. Okay. So I wanted to be sure that it, you know, when I was going through and trying to match everything up, that the language of the charter very closely matched what we've got in the ordinance, that the ordinance closely matched other things that were referenced in other ordinances. So,
very good. Any other questions?
Move the approval.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any other discussion?
Before we vote, Mike, did you have things that you wanted to add?
Oh.
Well, if we're ready to vote, I'll make some very briefly.
Yeah, don't tank it.
Yeah, the whole point is we need that we've been operating under a structure. We weren't following the rules, so we need to follow the rules, and this allows us to do that.
Thank you.
Motion and a second. Any other thoughts, discussions, questions? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
The motion carries. Item number 5.
Consider approval of change order number 7 for the Martin Luther King Street Reconstruction Project to Goodwin and Goodwin to modify contract quantities to match the attached final pay request number 10 from the contractor or take other necessary action.
Mr. Stewart.
Yeah, I'll start by telling you this is for final payment to Goodwin and Goodwin. The warranty has already started on that. The day that we did the dedication on the street was the day that we actually accepted the project as substantially complete. So that's when the warranty actually started. Today, we're just trying to get final payment out. We were going back and forth with them over some issues on quantities and on the liquidated damages on the days. I've got a real quick slide show to show you. It's just to remind you of what that project looked like before, what the street looked like, and what the finished product was. We're still very, very pleased with the project. It's a great one. The road looks extremely nice. We still have some issues out there that we need to address. One of them is we've got some work to do just in the neighboring areas where there was some damage to the streets that were done by having to move vehicle traffic and some construction equipment. Not the contractor's responsibility, it is ours, and we have done that in other areas on different projects. So as soon as the weather permits and we get to going in our paving season, we'll go over there and do some repair work. And it's all minor work. There's a block here, spots here.
Just side streets.
Just side streets. Also, as Councilman Johnson had asked, there's some issues on the curbs, the radiuses, where there's a grassy area that needs to be addressed. And we did not want to do anything to this project until this project was completely finalized with Goodwin and Goodwin, so we didn't jeopardize anything. But that's still stuff that we can look at as the paving season moves and we start doing that type work. And we'll have to make sure that whatever we do for that little area still needs to be ADA compliant so we don't get ourselves in any issues. But those are things that we still need to do. They're up to staff to do, and we intend to get those done.
But Goodwin and Goodwin, they did what they were asked to do on those issues.
Yes, they did.
Okay.
They built it as designed. And the design, as Councilman Johnson pointed out, is not the greatest because it does create a maintenance issue. It's going to create something that kind of is going to become unsightly if they don't take care of it. So it does need to be addressed. But it was designed that way. They did build it that way, so we can't penalize them.
Okay.
We're also taking that into consideration for any future projects that we won't do that type design. The side that I wanted to make sure that you were aware of is that the original bid price, we only had two bids, if you remember. We had the price from Goodwin and Goodwin, which was $3,408,926.50. And we had the other bid price was from Glover & Associates at $3,840,763.50. What we have before you today with reconciled amounts, which is reconciling some concrete quantities and some aggregate quantities, we're presenting today a final project amount of $3,677,197.14. That does include a liquidated damages assessment of $59,500. That is deducted in that final price. So
That is change order number 7. The next item on the bid, on the agenda is to actually approve that final payment. So, answer any questions. Jessica's here. Jessica did the inspection on this project, did very well. We learned a lot on it. She's actually doing a lot of the inspections on 43rd and 45th Street, getting a lot more in detail on it. So when we get on our next project and we have items on these reconciled prices and quantities, we have better records to go back to, and we don't have to sit in a table and negotiate that. So we do recommend final payment. Staff is okay with this. Contractor is okay with this. And we'll answer any questions.
Thank you, Mom.
I know that we had had some ground issues, and you put down that fancy mat and what have you.
Yeah, the Marafi liner.
Yes, sir.
Marafi liner.
Yes, sir. Which, all good stuff. Makes for a good road, good project. It was some of those upgrades included in this final price? Or is it a separate item?
If you're looking at change order number 7, which is in your packet,
mm-hmm.
it says on there change the contract price from previous change orders, and that was in that previous change order. That's in that 156 amount.
Okay.
So, any other questions?
Now, where are we at on them settling up with adjacent property owners on damage?
If we're talking about the one in particular that we've been addressing, we have emailed him, he has emailed back, and he has been in contact with them. And Councilor Johnson, that's the latest that I have from him. So we had passed along all your comments to him. He did respond to it and say he had been in contact with her, and that if she did have a claim, it would probably go to a legal issue. But he has reached out, and we have done our due diligence, I feel.
So he has responded back, that's it?
He has responded back to us that he did reach out to her. And we do have that in an email version. And I thought I'd forward that to you, but.
Yeah. Yeah.
Counselor, what was the, I'm lost. What was the concern, if you can?
We've just, on some, on some property owner's property, there was just mm-hmm. damage done from the contractor, and they were just not taken care of. It was, and part of it was Oklahoma natural gas. It was the contractor. It was kind of all between. Whose responsibility is it? Either way, you know, we need to make sure it's getting taken care of. Because ultimately, needs to be taken care of.
And damages that's to the earth or damages to physical structures?
These were damages to the wall. They had an old rock wall, kind of a WPA type constructed wall that had some cracks in it after the project had been completed. The homeowner had complained that she felt like that had been damaged during the Oklahoma natural gas process. That was turned over to Oklahoma Natural Gas to reconcile. She also had some claims over the work that was done around her driveway in her garage, causing her car to slide into the side of the garage door. And that was forwarded to the contractor. That was Goodwin and Goodwin. And again, Goodwin and Goodwin has told us they have reached out to her, and if she feels like that they still have not reconciled it properly, then it probably needs to go through the legal process. And that's all documented.
Mr. Tucker, is that something that the city needs to be involved in and trying to reconcile that?
No, it isn't. There is a provision in our contract that does require them to indemnify any issues that were against the city. They are required to have insurance. You know, we have articulated certain protections in there for the citizens who are involved in any of our projects that are adjacent, but it wouldn't be appropriate and would likely land us in some hot water if we were to, for example, withhold payment contingent upon the contractor settling the claim that they didn't believe they were legally responsible for doing.
Okay.
And that's really what my concern is. If if there was any withholding about that. Now, making sure that they have appropriately addressed the situation and that they have, you know, done their due diligence in meeting their obligations with us, then certainly we would have some say in that. And if Mr. Stewart's concerned about that, or not concerned about it, if he's satisfied that that has happened,
yes,
then that would be to the extent that we would need to be involved in.
Yes, and we have followed through with the emails. Jessica has emailed them. I've emailed them. We've made sure Matt has been involved. I do feel like the city has done the due diligence to follow through with this. The contractor does not feel like some of the claims are his responsibility, and that's why it probably will need to be a legal issue with him.
And Deputy Mayor, that's not terribly uncommon when you have some issues that come up. We, as you know, our office processes tort claims.
Mm-hmm.
There are a number of times when we have someone who believes that the city is responsible for damage, but legally we're not.
Mm-hmm.
And so we need to have the right to be able to deny those as a city. And similarly, the contractors still enjoy those rights. And there's, you know, that's why you have courts, arbitrations, things like that, who can ultimately decide that. And they're insured, so that's, I'm certain they'll turn it over to an adjuster who can handle that.
So you're still, so Mike, you're recommending that we
approve change order number 7. Yes.
Mr. Tucker, I assume, legally speaking, that we're bound to wrap this up?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions or discussion?
Yeah, Mr. Gulliman, be recognized.
Sure.
You know, it's a very good project on Walter Luther King Street, but my concern is that in the summertime when the grass starts growing, it looks bad. And a lot of times when those pieces of property over there, there's no houses, and the contractor has to go over there and cut the lots, and they don't edge it, and all that grass is going to do is grow on the sidewalk and make it look bad. I wish it was a way that we could solve that problem, but I don't know how we can. That's just my concern, okay, you know, to that situation over there on Martin Luther King Street, because it's a nice project.
Yep.
I turn the floor back over to you, Ms. Gunn.
Thank you.
I do appreciate Mike, and I appreciate Matt, because I visited with both of them regarding it. It's just kind of a challenging when we can only do what we can do, and it boils down to, you know, all the different contractors that worked on this project and making sure that everybody's taking care of their pieces. But again, overall, this was a wonderful, wonderful project. It's made a tremendous improvement, you know, in Martin Luther King Street. It's just there was a lot of challenges, mm-hmm, you know, with what went on with it. But I do really appreciate the help from the city staff at making sure everything was taken care of. Make a motion to approve.
Second. Got a motion and a second. Any other thoughts or discussion?
Martin Luther King Turnpike. It's awful nice.
There's a speed limit on that.
Oh.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Stewart, I just want to be sure that that resident still has the ability to be in contact with the contractor to see if they can have something resolved before they have to actually pursue legal means on their own. I want to be sure that door's still open.
They have the contact information, and we can reach out and make sure they still have it. We can send it again.
Okay.
And we can also send another email to the contractor, but I think that's probably the extent we should go through with. But we will do that, sir.
Okay.
Any other comments?
Oh, Mrs. Gulley, I mean,
sure.
Mr. Stewart, it's like, you know, when the contractor, say if it's a vacant lot on Martin Luther King, okay, and we, you know, we post that, you know, when the grass is high, and then the contractor goes over there and cut the grass. Is there any way the contractor can edge it? I mean, along the concrete, is that something can be done? I mean,
I'm not sure that has anything to do with this contract.
No, I know. I'm just saying.
I know where you're at. But I don't, we can bring that up on the nuisance abatement program when that comes.
Or in how we actually put our contracts together that takes care of those issues, whether we want them to edge.
I think it'd be nice to have a review of that as we go forward in the summer. Any other comments pertaining to this item? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gulley.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Cale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
And the motion carries. Item number 6.
Consider approval of final payment on the Martin Luther King Street reconstruction project to Goodwin & Goodwin in the amount of $255,109.86, or take other necessary action.
Mr. Stewart.
This is the final payment to Goodwin & Goodwin that takes in the change order number 7 adjustments, and the final payment is for $255,109.86, and we do recommend approval.
Move for approval.
Second.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any discussion? Roll call.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Danny Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Cale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Can we have discussion?
In the middle of the roll call?
Well, I didn't have a chance to.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Was this for quantity differences?
This reconciled some quantity differences that change order number 7 just did, and it was concrete quantities and some ag base where, you know, we had to go in and put the Merify, and it was 100 and right at 80,000 that we actually owed price. Them, and then we modified the price in change order number 7 to get to the 255.
Did we not feel like the documents were strong enough to clear?
As I stated earlier, we have learned that we could do a better job in some of our documentation. We felt pretty firm in our adjustments, and they felt pretty firm in theirs, and we did come to an agreement on some of the quantities. Hope that answered your question.
Okay. I apologize.
Sorry about that.
It was just moving through, but I really did have questions on that.
That's
item.
Fine.
$250,000. Big mistake.
All right.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coburn.
Yes.
And the motion carries. Seeing that no citizens wish to speak, we are adjourned.
Now I call to order the Muskogee Municipal Authority. Roll call, please.
Mayor Bob Coburn.
Here.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Here.
Dan Hall.
Here.
Marlon Coleman.
Here.
Janie Boydston.
Here.
Wayne Johnson.
Here.
Patrick Cale.
Here.
Ivory Van.
Here.
Derek Reed.
Here.
Before we start on this, I had an opportunity today to be at Hilldale School today and yesterday and speak to about 100 of their seniors. What a great experience. Mrs. Fleetwood is the instructor of that class, and it was a great opportunity, and I am excited about the interest of young people to get involved in city government as at the elected official level and as a citizen level. And I just want to say a word of appreciation to Hilldale Schools and to Mrs. Fleetwood. Item number one.
Receive a presentation regarding necessary water and wastewater projects to be funded by a series of loans from the Oklahoma Water Resources Board, and if appropriate, consider and take action with respect to a resolution agreeing to file applications with the Oklahoma Water Resources Board for financial assistance through the OWRB Drinking Water and Clean Water State Revolving Fund programs, with the loan proceeds being for the purpose of financing certain water and wastewater system and related improvements serving the city of Muskogee, Oklahoma, approving professional services agreement and containing other provisions related thereto.
It's a much shorter paragraph than we dealt with a minute ago, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Mike Miller.
Yes, well, this is a project that we've worked on for a long time. The City Council and the citizens of Muskogee have realized that we need to take care of some long-deferred maintenance on infrastructure projects. And so what we're excited about today is that we've really kind of come to a point where we are ready to move forward. So I've got we've discussed this for a long time, and in some of the discussions where we really need to boil this down and see if we can make a relatively short presentation that is easy for us to pass on to our citizens. So what I'm going to try and do is give a short overview of the general ideas of the subject. We've got our engineers here that can address specifics of the project, and Mr. Stewart to correct any mistakes that I make along the way. Then we can talk about anything that has to do with the questions related specifically to the projects, and then we'll talk about how we can pay for these moving forward. So as we've talked about before, we've got aging infrastructure. You all, as a city council, have already funded the improvements that we're about to take. You said we need to address these issues. We put rate increases in place, and we've earmarked those for capital improvements for water and sewer. And so what we've got is a chance to look at our 100-year-old infrastructure and go project by project and say, what is our highest priority? So as part of our doing that, we've identified water projects. And here's that list. We'll go through those one by one. And we've also identified some sewer infrastructure improvement projects. We'll go through those one by one. So, again, as part of this plan, we've had staff working on it. We've had engineers working on it. We've gotten the city council to plan over the last couple of months for both sides that they've been able to review. And so right now we're ready to look at each individual item. So we look at our first water line replacement. It speaks for itself. We've got 24-inch water lines that run from the water treatment plant into town. Those are 100-year-old lines. And when they break, it's a big problem for us. And so we think that fixing those and replacing those is a high priority. We have also proposing a hydraulic water model that basically makes it easier for us to make good decisions on how we develop our infrastructure in the future, especially in relation to the next project, which is a water loss control program and audit. We have a lot of water that we pump out of our water treatment plant that doesn't end up going through our meters. So we're going to, this analysis will help us identify efficiencies in our system. Occasionally, our citizens get a notice in their water bills that we have an issue with some disinfectant byproducts in our water. And so the next item is something that directly addresses that, and we think it needs to be done. We're going to install mixing systems of the large storage tanks that we have. Not only will it help address those issues that we get from DEQ, but it also improve the taste and odor of our water. Next item on our list is repairing, and not just repairing, but replacing 6 to 12-inch water lines and having a program and a plan to do that. We haven't been able to do that in the past on a regular basis, and this will help us replace aging infrastructure that are a little less significant than the 24-inch water lines, but still very significant. The last one we have on our water treatment side is we're going to move the chlorine treatment of our raw water from the dam at Fort Gibson to our water treatment plant. It's a best practice in the industry, and we feel like it's important. When we go to our sewer improvements, we've finished the Cootie Creek sewer line, but we realized that there's some multiple bypasses nearby that shouldn't be happening. And so when we looked at those, we figured out that there were a couple lines that had just collapsed. And they're in the junction area, and we're going to fix those, and that should help that community immensely. On the north and east side of town, we've got the port lift stations that are aging, and they're aging rapidly. They're a big maintenance problem, and as we're recruiting industry to town, we want to upgrade those and increase capacity to try and help economic development. We're also going to combine and consolidate three existing older lift stations into one on the northeast side of town. A couple of issues on the west side. As you see, the Four Corners area is highlighted there. As we see more development on the west side of town, we need to increase capacity for our sewer system. And so we also have some sewer lines that aren't sized properly. They need to be larger than they currently are. And so we're going to fix those on there. And finally, in our urban renewal area, we're seeing expanded growth, and we need to expand our capacity there as well. And that's what this north side sewer upgrades are. So that's a quick look at it. Again, it's about $45 million in projects overall. And they're important. They're the highest priority items that we've addressed with two different engineering firms helping our staff analyze our infrastructure and what our current needs are. This is a way for us to fulfill the promise that we've made to our citizens. We said we're going to take these rate increases and we're going to fix the infrastructure. And we've taken our time. We've made a good plan to do that. And now it's time for us to go ahead and say, let's move forward with these projects. We have the financing available, and it's an exciting day for me because I think we're ready to make some progress that's long overdue. So right now what I'd like to do is ask you guys if you have questions related specifically to those projects. When we're done with those questions and we feel like we're ready to move forward with the projects, we'll start talking about the financing.
So, Mr. Miller, several of us have met over lunch and gone over this presentation. Has there been any significant changes between that initial presentation and what you've showed us?
There's not significantly. We did feel like since we were going out for financing, there are a couple of things that I neglected to mention that they are in your packet that weren't in the presentation here. Some equipment, a sewer truck, a grade all, some sewer plant improvements. We've recently decided that we need to upgrade some things there. Civitan drainage project that you guys have already been involved with has already come through for engineering purposes. We would include that in contingencies for water meter replacement. Those are included in the $45 million package, and we didn't specifically address those.
Okay.
But what this authorization will let us do these projects.
Okay. So this is the presentation you pretty much gave yes. myself mm-hmm. and other council members
yeah, we,
a couple weeks
ago. Right. Okay. I covered it quickly, but the staff and the council has spent a lot of time in preparation for learning about these projects.
Okay. Can you just send us a brief bullet list of what those changes were? Because I was going to ask the same question sure. that Councilor Gully did.
Yeah, and it, yes, I will, certainly.
Thank you.
So we definitely are going to get a new grade hall?
That's part of the project. That yeah, the financing would include, yes, the purchase of a new grade hall. Yes, sir.
That piece of equipment is very important to the city. It's used all the time.
Okay.
Is this final action on this, or does this go to council on a Monday night?
This would be final action.
Okay.
So exactly what are you asking for us to go out and look for the bond issues now, or right. just approve the program?
Well, the next step is that we have the ability. One of the things that we analyze is how much can we borrow? Mm-hmm. You know, how much can we afford, right? We have more projects that probably mm-hmm. than $45 million worth that we need to do because we have so much deferred maintenance. So we did an analysis of, number one, how much can we borrow based on the income we have from our rate increases? And number two, we didn't want to commit every penny from our rate increases to paying down this loan. What if something comes up? What if we decide we have other smaller projects year to year that we want to do? So this is committing far less of than 100% of our mm-hmm. rate increases for these projects. So in the future, if we identify another big project, we could get another loan. And if year to year, if we say no, somebody asked about the effectiveness that we had on a contracting fixing leaks. Or just earlier today, and we had about $120,000 contract, and we targeted and fixed a whole bunch of leaks with the help of a contractor. This would allow us keep money in the MMA for us to continue to do projects like that and really do focused response.
Okay, so you're asking us to approve an issuance of bonds for up to $45 million, which would basically be a line of credit. We only borrow what we need at that present time, so we're not going to have like a regular loan have $45 million in the bank. And the interest starts on the $45 million.
That's correct. We draw it as we need it, and that helps keep our costs low. The other thing I'd mention is that, you know, interest rates are low now, mm-hmm. and they're tending to head upward. And so the sooner we can get, if we're able to get these loans through the Water Resources Board, we'll have that interest rate whether we draw down the whole $45 million immediately or not.
So I was thinking the report that you gave us on Friday, it would look like there was two loans.
There will probably be at least four loans.
Okay.
There's two different kinds of loans. And I may just ask our bond counsel and our financial advisor to come up and address how those are handled.
I'm sitting there so anxiously.
Council. Mr. Miller's correct. The way we were going to plan on putting this together was to actually make an application, all right, to the Water Resources Board. There's a program for water system improvements, and there's a program for sewer system improvements. So the two separate programs, very similar in nature. But then, as the projects are engineered, as you kind of get ready to actually do construction, all right, then there could be a series of loans that would be forthcoming. We would have to come back to you, obviously, all right, tonight or this afternoon. We're basically just asking for consideration of the resolution in front of you to authorize submission of the loan applications. And then as the projects progress with your engineering group and with the Water Resources Board, then we would come back to you from time to time with specific projects and specific dollar amounts for your consideration and approval at that point. So this is really not a final approval, obviously, on the financing, but it is the first step subject to us being able to get back. And I do agree with Mr. Miller, obviously, on interest rates. We've seen a significant increase in interest rates over the last couple of months. They've kind of slowed down a little bit, but the Federal Reserve, as you may have just read in the paper, is already talking about raising rates maybe as early as next week, and so we do anticipate rates hopefully gradually going up over time. So it is important to kind of capture those to the extent that we possibly can.
Okay. I'm move for approval.
I might make one.
Nope, I'm sorry.
Never mind, you're approving.
I'm no, We're privy to the reports and that sort of stuff, and I just want to make sure that let the citizens know that we have vetted this in subcommittees and, mm-hmm. and looked at this. This is, you know, borrow $45 million since some of it's not going to be paid back to 2049, if I'm not mistaken, 32 years from here. You know, I want people to understand that we've been studying this project, and it's not something that we just lightly address and say, okay, we're going to go $45 million on some infrastructure. And I just want to make sure everybody understands, because I think this is what we promised when we raised the rates, that we would do these projects and really improve our infrastructure. So I'm supportive of it, but I think we've vetted it out very well, and staff has too.
I think, about 2 years into it?
It's been a while. Yes. Alan, did you have a comment as well?
Well, I just wanted to make one comment. Our goal is to get closed on these lines of credit or financings at the earliest possible date we can. So as an example, we've asked the Oklahoma Water Resources Board to do some things in connection with this loan they haven't done before. On the wastewater side, we're asking them to allow us to close a loan at a fairly high dollar amount, and what we anticipate would cover the wastewater projects as a whole before the engineering is complete. And that's a positive from the city standpoint, in the sense this is a line of credit. We don't get to lock down that interest rate or fix that interest rate until we actually close a loan. So the larger dollar amount we can come back to you with for approval and closing means that rate is set, all right? I just asked Rick a question before the meeting. I said, you know, if on $45 million, what does a 0.25% interest rate right. increase cost? Well, interest rates go up by 0.25% on $45 million over 30 years. I mean, this was kind of on his phone, but it was about $2.25 million. So if we can lock as much of this money down at rates that are at rates we see today, our thought is a year or two or three or 4 years from now, rates have a better chance of being higher than perhaps being lower. So that means as these projects move forward, as they're engineered, every one of the projects will come back to the council for final approval. If we end up having too many dollars in the line of credit, we de-obligate it, all right? If the projects come in higher, then you all will kind of be shuffling between these project dollars as we move forward, as the engineer's estimates at this point become bid projects. So again, our hope is to have an application turned in to the Oklahoma Water Resources Board this week, and we'd like to be back in front of you hopefully in the next 30 days approving some transaction.
Just from an engineering standpoint, the wastewater projects seem to be able to be accelerated and expedited quicker than some of the water projects. So we actually have already kind of had some preliminary meetings with the Water Resources Board indicating that Muskogee was interested in going back to this program. You've used it, as most of you know, extensively in the past because it is a very favorable funding vehicle. And so we actually have materials, applications, supporting documents, and so forth related to the wastewater system improvements that we're in a position to submit immediately to get those in the queue. And then we'll be following that, all right, with some of the important water projects as they progress.
Okay, does council have a question or comment?
I'm just glad that we're moving forward on this, especially after looking at the water lines and the pictures that they had and the 100-year raw water line coming into Muskogee. This, I'm kind of proud of this. This isn't something where you build a monument out front of your building. This is that ugly stuff that is necessary to have a quality of life in Muskogee. And $45 million is a lot of money. And, I mean, when we started this back in 3-4 years ago, looking at this and knowing that we had to change some of this stuff around, I'm excited. I mean, this is some of those things they hide under the dirt and you don't ever get to see it again. But when you turn your water faucet on and the water's clean, and when you flush your toilet and everything goes the right way, you go, huh, they did a good job. And this, I would love for some of this stuff to took place 45, 50 years ago instead of now. But it's on our shoulders to do this. And so I second Mr. Gulley's motion. Thank y'all for all your work.
Mm-hmm. Motion and a second. Is there other comments?
The challenge is this is just the beginning. don't think this is the fix. We will still have 100-year-old lines in the city of Muskogee.
Yeah.
This is just the first step.
This won't all be knocked out in the next 12 months.
No.
That's
no.
true.
This is the first step at moving the city in the right direction of repairing infrastructure that has been neglected. But this is the first right step.
Good job.
Other comments?
This also lets our citizens know that what we're doing is very, you know, well taken, and we're doing it for them and us, you know, and
preparing for
our
future
city.
Growth.
For very future growth. So I definitely agree on this project.
Good.
Thank you, Mr. Miller, for your report.
Roll call, please.
Deputy Mayor. Comment?
Well, the credit needs to go to the staff. Mr. Stewart and his staff have done a lot of work, so they deserve all the credit.
Thank you, Mr. Stewart, for all of your hard work and your staff.
Ready? I am. If you are.
We ready for roll call? Okay.
Deputy Mayor James Gully.
Yes.
Janie Boydston.
Yes.
Patrick Kale.
Yes.
Marlon Coleman.
Yes.
Wayne Johnson.
Yes.
Ivory Van.
Yes.
Derek Reed.
Yes.
Dan Hall.
Yes.
Mayor Coben.
Yes. And before we close, surely we get Pam to read another long paragraph.
No, thank you.
At least once.
No, thank you.
That concludes our agenda for today. Thank you for joining us.